I couldn't tell you last time I spoke to you. Couldn't tell you. Whoa, that's a little staticky. Couldn't tell you the last time I did a podcast. Couldn't tell you. Reason being, I disconnected to connect. The truth be told, the world has gotten to me. I started watching the news. I started paying attention to what people have to say. And I'll be honest with you. I've come to the conclusion that just because you have something to say doesn't mean that it should be heard. I mean, we all have that right, don't we? Mostly. Most of us have that right. Depending on where you were born on this earth, you may live in a place where someone controls what you say. Someone controls what you say, what you do, what you think. I happen to been blessed to be born in the United States of America. And some will say, you still don't even have the option to say what you want, say what you mean, think the way you wish to, go where you want to. I think, but for the most part, that is true, though, that we can indeed enjoy freedom here. But just sitting back lately and observing what people think, what people do, how they behave, what their opinions are, and I see them as varied as the stars above and the grains on the earth and the sand. We all have different opinions about different things. Pivotable time coming up, pivotal in our country's history. Another election. And you got one side screaming about the other side, and one side swears to be right, and the other side swears to be right as well. And it just fascinates me how people on either side, again, people in general, can form an opinion about something and maybe be not fully in tune of the facts. I don't think any of us are. We only hear what we're being fed, and we form opinions from that. But it kind of reminds me, all this information overload about who to vote for, it kind of reminds me of a song that, like a really bad song in the 70s. And I don't know, I don't have one in particular that I'm thinking about, but we all have that one song that like, oh my God, I hate that song. But by the time the disc jockeys and the record companies and the payola got done with you, the payola is when the record companies back in the day, or the producers or whoever they were, would pay the local radio stations, the disc jockeys, to play their song. I want you to play the heck out of this song. And we'll brainwash everybody to think it's a great song. Because that's what happens. You see, all it's got to do is have a little bit of a catchy tune, but it could be the goofiest, stupidest, most ridiculous, dumbest song you ever heard. But if you hear it enough, you're going to start humming it. Because if that's all there is to hear and to listen to, you're going to start humming it along with it. And that's no different from what we're experiencing right now. You hear, you see, you're bombarded with the commercials, the millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars in advertising dollars that they spend to convince you their side's right, the other side's wrong, this and that. And I'm not going to tell you who's right or who's wrong. I'm just telling you I'm at that information overload part where I disconnected. Then I started getting in a mood. My brother-in-law, Ronnie, called me Angry Tony yesterday. He said, I'd like to give Angry Tony a trophy. I was laughing at him because for the longest time, and I'm still, you know, even-minded, even-keeled Tony somewhere in there. But for the longest time, I'm always trying to level the battlefield for everybody, to be that negotiator, to be that networking guy, to bring people to the table, to see maybe what their inabilities to see truly are. And I surrender. I raise my hands in complete surrender. And you remember, if you're a longtime listener, that word surrender is, you know, never in my vocabulary, right? But I'll tell you right now, I surrender. I've had conversations with people, conversations that I thought were completely coherent, that were logical, that made total sense. We spoke in, you know, layman terms so anybody could understand it. Point, counterpoints. And at the end of the conversation, they went right back to square one on what they thought and what they believed. Because I truly believe they were indoctrinated, brainwashed, bamboozled into believing, listen to this, are you ready for this? Into believing what they want to believe. Not necessarily what they're told to believe. And I think what happens is we take information and we assimilate it to our way of thought. And we utilize it that way to conform to our lives and to conform and make us feel better about what we're believing in, and therefore reinforcing our thought process that we are thinking in the proper context. I'll also have people that totally disagree with me in regards to the value of our vote. That doesn't matter. Again, I'm not going to give you answers for any of the type of stuff. I'm just telling you where I've been. I feel like I'm Major Tom. I've been drifting. Disconnecting to connect. And have I connected? Reconnected? Well, I've reinforced what I've always believed in, what is true to me, what is valuable to me, what is most important to me, my family values, my moral compass. I got it. I know what I want. I know what I think is good for myself and for my family. And they all have to make their own decisions as well. As individuals, we all have to think for ourselves. You're getting fed stories about doing this and doing that. And I'm the kind of guy that walks into a restaurant. If you make a mistake, I'm cool with that. Acknowledge you made a mistake. Please fix that mistake, because I'm about to pay you hard-earned money for the product that you're putting out, that I came into your place, your place of establishment, your place of business, place of establishment, your place of establishment, your established business, your establishment, right? I came in there to buy your product. You're pronouncing and advertising and telling the world how wonderful your product is, and this is going to change my taste buds for the better, and it's going to be a wonderful experience. But what if it isn't? Do I give you a second chance? Chances are I do. But are you getting a third? I don't know. Now, we're going to do a couple twists here. I went into a large store recently. And I was in a hurry. I'm not normally in a hurry, but I was in a hurry. I had people waiting for me. I only needed two simple items. And I went, I got to the store probably an hour and a half after they opened. I knew exactly where I had to go to get this product, right? It was a cooler, a little personal lunch cooler that I had probably 20 of them in my life. I had one forever. It was my work cooler. I had all my union stickers on it. You know, any other stickers that I just accumulated over the years, they went on. It was almost like a badge of honor. The dirtier it got from the outside, it was like, you know, it was tested and tried, and it was used, and it represented something. I should have never thrown it away. It's gone. Maybe some trash man took it out of the trash and got it on his shelf somewhere in his garage. But there was a couple items that I wish I never would have thrown away. That, my headphones meaning like ear protection. Had these big Mongo like earmuff type of headphones that I used to wear down the airport. Nowadays, they're just putting the phone plugs in there or whatever they happen to use. Old school was that, right? And then That's kind of like, oh, my hard hat. My hard hat from when I worked down the oil refineries and the different areas where I had to have a hard hat on. And again, you accumulate your stickers to that. I remember having, it was a white hard hat. Had my stickers all over it. And I had my name Tony written across the front of that in black magic marker. It was cool. And that was my uniform. It's what you wore. Right? You had to wear it. Not only that, with safety glasses, Nomex fire retardant suit, the ear protection as well. That was a different pair of ear protection than I had at the airport. But still, I wish I would have had it. But what that stuff represented to me was much more than just the individual things that they were, you know. They represented years and dedication of hard work, effort to matter, to make a difference to people I love, to go out and earn a living, to work towards the opportunity to earn that living, to go to school and to learn and to sacrifice. I remember sitting there when World Hockey Championships were going on and I was studying psychometric charts, electrical charts, Ohm's Law, all this stuff to pass test. And I couldn't turn that on. I had a test I had to study for. Those are sacrifices to me. Hockey was everything to me. And so we do all this. And when I looked at those items, when I first had my problem with the health, anger took over and I threw it all out. It's another part of my life. I needed to start a new chapter and I didn't want anything to do with anything from my old life because I didn't know what this new life was going to be. But looking at that stuff represented something to me. The long road I had to hoe to get to where I was. Nobody handed me anything. I worked for it. Nobody just got me in a union. I'm not embarrassed to tell you. I found out who the president of the union was, and I sat on his front porch. I knocked on his door, just waiting for him to talk to him. What's it take to get into your union? You'd be like, dude, you're out of your mind. Am I? I don't care. That's how I roll. I wanted a job in an airline one time, and the general manager for PHL for Philadelphia, I just sat in front of his office one day. And I said, hey, I know you get this job opening up. I might not be fully qualified, but I was wondering if you would consider me. Here's my application. A little unorthodox. Stop and see him. Like once a week. We haven't made up our mind, Tony. We haven't made up our mind yet. Okay. And it became once a day. Did you make up your mind yet? Did you make up your mind yet? He says, please come in my office. I said, all right. Because you really want this job, don't you? I said, yeah. He goes, why do you want to work for us? Incredible airline. I see a future there. I love aircraft. I love the whole concept of flight, commercial flight, everything about it. Fascinating from the aerospace engineering, aeronautical engineering, excuse me, that makes it all happen to the ground process, to the cargo, everything about it. It just fascinates me. And he talks to me, he's talking to me about my life and talking to me about my, you know, personal life and, you know, how's everything going? You know, everything's cool. You know, got a girlfriend, you're planning to get married someday. You still want to live in this area. You know, what happens if we close down here and you got to move to another? Yeah, it's cool. We'll do it. So he says, you know what? There's a pause. And this was a very strict, very regimented man. He says, Tony, you want that job? You got the job. He goes, but before you give me your answer that, yes, I want the job, I want you to take a few days because I'm going to write other things down that I've been writing on this paper, just a few more things. And I want you to take this home and just think about what I see in you. I said, okay, I will do that. He goes, but rest assured, if you want the job, it's yours. He goes, but this is what I see in you. And so he gave me this piece of paper, and I walked off. I'm like on cloud nine that I'm going to work for this company. I'm thinking, you know, free air, travel, all over the world. That's important to me. And I took this letter home and I opened it up and I started reading it. And I started learning about the image that I personally gave off to others and what this man saw in me. And he kind of knew me from, you know, being around. We worked as subcontractors for his company, for his airline. So he knew me, you know. You know, you got a great attitude. You're positive. Everybody likes you. Because, but what I see, Tone, is a lot more promise than a guy maybe spending the rest of his life possibly working in cargo. And not that there's anything wrong with that. You know, maybe just on a ground service type thing. There's nothing wrong with that. He says, but the way your mind works, I just got a feeling you're not going to be happy. You will now for the next 5 years or so. But Tone, there's more to life than this. Because I think you're destined for great things. Again, job's yours. Please let me know. And I really thought about what this gentleman said. Because he took the time to try to understand me. And he knew my enthusiasm. He knew how pumped up I was. Obviously, I'm basically knocking down his door to get this job. However, something clicked inside my head. I'm like, this guy's kind of right. Because I do get that way with careers. It's got to be challenging. I mean, it's got to be challenging all the time. And so it was weird to say no to something that I wanted so bad. And I did. I went back and I talked to him. I said, you know what? Man, I see what you're talking about. I said, I just went into this with a totally open mind reading your letter, and I'm okay with what you said. I think you're accurate. I said, I want to thank you for taking the time to do that because you're a young man and you have the world ahead of you. He says, I just don't want you to make a mistake of grounding yourself. He goes, and simultaneously, I see that, you know, the life that you love, you're a lover of life. You want to get out there in the world. You want to see things. He goes, but don't be blinded about, you know, the free air. Maybe that's what you would want to do here, the free air travel. Maybe that's that part of that zeal, that zest for life, that to travel and to meet other people and stuff. I said, because I just don't think you would be happy just in this position right here, even if you moved up later. And the position was in the cargo section, that particular position. I said, you know what, sir? I said, thank you. He says, continue on with college and shoot for the stars. But, you know, take the time every once in a while to talk to yourself, to analyze yourself and see, what do you really want? And I did that thanks to this guy. And he was not the guy. No one would ever think this is the guy that would be cool like that. Everybody was kind of scared of him. I mean, I'm not, people do not intimidate me. I like to talk to people because I want to learn from myself. And that's how you learn. Sometimes when someone speaks to you, and you know, it happened not long ago. I told you about it, a little meeting. I had a little talk with my buddy. It's like, dude, what's your deal? You know, we don't get it. You want to hang out with us? You want to spend time with us? The first response was to speak French. I say, who are you, man, to talk to me that way? This is how I roll. But it's a part of the personal growth that I've always had to suck that up and say, you know what? I'll hear you out. What do you got to say? It's called constructive criticism. I mean, you can make a destructive criticism if you wish, but it's all how you retain this information that's being spoken to you. And do you even respect the source it's coming from? And I do. I did in both instances. And so learning from other people and being quiet and listening and saying, you know what? You know, see yourself as not flawless, but potentially having flaws or having things that can build and strengthen your personal character. And I did that in both instances with my friend not long ago, a couple months ago, and he understood where I was coming from, and I think I understand where he's coming from. And, you know, you learn about people, and you understand them. You don't have to. You don't have to take that path. But if people care about you and they want to hang out with you, or they want you to work for them, or you want to work for them, there's a little negotiation has to happen there. It's like even a relationship. If you're in a relationship with your loved one, me with my wife, I can't always have things my way. She can't always have things her way. You got to sit there and you got to listen to each other. And guys, if you're a type A like I am, and ladies, if you're a type A like my wife is, and all my daughters are, that's four type A's we had living in this house at one time. You got to learn how to give and take, to understand, to shut up and listen to each other. And sometimes you just want to talk and you want to, you know, have the final say. And that's not how you grow, right? And so way back to the beginning, in regards to this political conversation I'm having with someone, thinking that we're making leaps and bounds in progress here, understanding. And at the end, this person's like, yeah, right back to where I was thinking in the beginning. They were. And I'm like, okay. So sometimes you just can't reason with people. What are you going to do? So instead of how I was getting just totally frustrated, observing things and how people, as how I'm seeing, can be pigheaded or wish to hear something and listen to something and then curtail that and conform it to their own belief system. It is what it is. So back to the box door, I got to get in line. There's two lines open. Actually, I would call it two lines. One with about nine people in it, and the other one with about, I don't know, eight people, seven people, something like that. But a lot of people had items in their baskets, and a few people had like one item. Well, I see this, and I look over to the self-checkout. You know the self-checkout now, right, where you see in every store, like we suddenly work for them. Like we're going to scan our own stuff, and that's just how it is, right? Now they're going to say, well, yeah, it's not job losses for those stores. It's actually you're putting the computer people in a work situation. They got to keep the things running and stuff. Well, anyway, we have four people standing over there in the self-checkout line and the gates halfway pulled across. And I see the lights lit green, right? That means green means go. So I kind of like, you know, slid right past that gate because it was a little nudged open. And suddenly I'm yelled at. Don't you see the gate? Don't you see the gate? That quick, the defense mechanism goes up. What gate? That gate right there. Don't you see that gate? I don't see any gate. I see a sign right here, a light. It says green. I see a line over there, two lines actually, with a lot of people waiting in line. And I see four people standing here. Jeez, I don't know. I just thought this was open because most of the time you'll want us to come here. Well, we're not open yet. And then I think about that one thing where customer's always right. And this woman was talking to me like she hated me. She didn't know me. And that neighborhood, if you were from my neighborhood, you know what I'm talking about. But you're a lot of listeners out there that do know where I'm from, and you're from my neighborhood, and you know what I'm talking about because you can't take that town out of you. You could take you out of the town, but you're not taking that town out of you. So the neighborhood is knocking on my noggin. Go ahead, Tone. You can own these people. Put them right in their spot. I said, listen, you got four people standing here. The light's green. Okay, the gate's halfway open. You got two lines over there that is they're not moving. But we ain't open yet. I laughed, smiled. I said to myself, shut up and go get in line. So I shut up and I went in line. And the line was moving very slowly. And out of the corner of my eye, I see a woman walking to the little gap that I had just in front of me, because I don't like to stand right on top of somebody. If I could smell their deodorant or their breath, I'm way too close, right? So I give like that 2-3 foot space. This lady pulls her cart right in front of mine, looks at me. Hmm. She gives me a, hmm. And just went forward. The woman behind me, I hear her go. Huh. I turn around and look at her. She's like, I'll tell you, not only are we working for them here, right? But, you know, you have people like that woman in front of you that is just rude and ignorant. I said, what are you going to do? You know? And it was right there. I was like, you know what, dude, slow down. Don't get sucked up into, you'll all know this because you listened for a while, the vortex of negativity. Don't let yourself get there. But I was kind of there. But I took a deep breath and I looked at her. I go, how's your day going, by the way? She just laughed. She goes, it's going okay. I'm doing all right. How are you doing? I don't know this woman from Adam. She says, I'm doing great. She goes, you have a blessed day. I said, no, you have a blessed day. And she's like, no, you have one. I go, no, you have a better one. And we just stood there laughing. Well, meanwhile, the little woman in front of us, she's smoking. She got smoke coming out of her ears. And she looked at my two items, and because I picked up something else other than the cooler, and it gives me a huh again. And she, after minutes and minutes and minutes, she checks out and looks back at me and gives me another huh. And then the lady who yelled at me earlier walked by and gave me a hmm. And I just looked back at the lady behind me, and she says, shaking her head, don't be like them. I said, I'm not. I said, I'm glad I met you. I said, I'm happy I met you. I said, you have a fantastic day. She goes, I will. She goes, you have a fantastic day wherever you're going. And I just smiled. I said, lady, how you doing? The lady was waiting on us, the cashier. She goes, oh, hi, how are you? I said, fine. I'm having a great day. Was I having a great day? You know, I was after talking to this lady. I was after realizing that not everybody who's different from you hates you or dislikes you. Maybe people are just aggravated at the situations that they're in. That's none of my business. I really don't care. Sometimes it's going to be directed at me. I can't take it personally. It just happens. So went fishing that day. Had a great time with a buddy of mine, Jim. Hello, Jim. You're out there. And it was beautiful because I haven't been fishing like that ever. Freshwater fishing out on a boat, it was like a V-hull boat, not like a John boat. However, you know, you're on a flat lake and the water is flat and serene and the sky was blue and beautiful and the breeze was slight, but it was about 70, 71 degrees. Sun was shining. We're all covered up watching some protection. And it wasn't about catching fish. It was about fishing. Just thinking about, you know, putting your lure on, casting it out there, reeling it in, see if anything bites. We got one fish, one and a half fish, I'll call it, because he got one, pulled it right at the boat and right at the last second, it got off. So I'm going to count that as a fish, half a fish. And then I caught I forget what the heck it was called. I don't remember what the name of the fish was. Perch. It was a perch. And we let that guy go. And that was about 5 hours of doing that, 6 hours of doing that. Let me tell you something. It was so peaceful and serene. Talk about disconnecting to connect. It was fantastic. And I thank my buddy for taking me up there. And I don't know if I'm going to thank him for putting the fishing bug in me, man. But let me tell you something. That was just, I want more. Right? So afterwards, I get home. We're helping Jim clean the boat out or just take the stuff out of the boat, get everything set up and put away. And my wife texts me, hey, we're going to go to dinner. Would you like to go to dinner? I said, you know what? Why don't you just go with my oldest daughter. You guys have a nice ladies' night at dinner. And she goes, well, get yourself something nice on the way home. Get yourself. I said, yeah, I will. So I stop at a place. And can I tell you what kind of food it was? Does it matter? It was chicken. I wanted some chicken. I wanted chicken, and I wanted coleslaw and I wanted the biscuit. So I pull up and they said, wait. I said, pardon me? Wait a minute. Okay. I waited 8 minutes and I would periodically would say, hello, hello. And that little voice inside my head's like, pull away while you can. And this is segueing into, you know, when you give a restaurant a second chance. They've already had a second chance. I've had situations here before. Just attitude. And so I said, nah, you know what? I'll give him another chance. This is the third chance now. What do you want? Hey, yeah, I'll take a 3-piece chicken and a side of coleslaw. No combos. I said, okay, I don't want a combo. I said, I'd just like a 3-piece chicken, please. And just a side of coleslaw. No coleslaw. And suddenly I'm having flashbacks of Seinfeld with the soup Nazi. No coleslaw for you. I said, okay, how about the chicken and a drink? No drinks. Now I'm like, that's the attitude of the old neighborhood coming in again. Go ahead, don't get him. Okay. How about a beer? Can I get a beer? Ice cold? Crickets, right? Nothing. So I'm just sitting there. People behind me. I mean, what am I going to do? Okay, what do you want? I said, should I repeat everything or what? I want the chicken, 3-piece chicken, and I would like this side of coleslaw. I told you we don't have any coleslaw. I said, all right, you know what? I slide to the other side of the menu. I said, this got to be easier. How about 3 Taco Supremes? Pause. Nothing. Hello? Hello? Nothing. Okay. Can I have 3 Taco Supremes? Hello? Nothing. Now I'm like, I'm giddy. I'm giddy, goofy. Like, where's the camera at, right? Is this really happening? This is 10, 15 minutes of my, a good 10 minutes of my time. What do you want? I said 3 Taco Supremes. Anything else? No. Right there. I should have just left. Everything was telling me, drive. Just go past this window. Just drive. I get to the window. A guy's standing there. He's got his arm out of the window, but he's not looking at me. His hand's open. I said, yeah. He's not looking at me. I said, excuse me. He won't look at me. I'm like, what in God's name is going on in this place? So, okay, I figure, okay, credit card. I hand my credit card, shoved it in his fingers. He takes my credit card, window slams. I'm like, what am I doing today? That's wrong. Fishing was great. Fishing was fantastic. About a minute or two, window opens, an arm comes out. The guy's not looking at me again. He's holding the receipt. I'm like, all right, he's just going to hold that receipt until he looks at me. He's not looking at me. I'm like, all right, I got to get the heck out of here. Grab the receipt out of his hand. He pulls his arm back, slams the window. I'm like, this cannot be happening to me. This is Tony here. I'm nice to everybody. Hey, how you doing? Hey, how you doing? This is Tony. You know me. A couple minutes go by. I'm at 50. Sorry about that. Folks, I got to be at over 10 minutes. Over 10 minutes. A bag of food comes out with an arm, and it's just hovering there, and I'm looking, and I'm just going to stare at this bag until this man turns and acknowledges my existence. And he doesn't. And he's not talking to anybody else. It's just an arm holding my 3 Taco Supremes. And then the neighborhood, you know, our neighborhood mentality, it's banging on my head with a fist. Do something. Say something. Let them know. Don't let people treat you like this. So I just grabbed the hand. I grabbed the bag, And I said, just like this, "Thank you very much, sir. You have a fantastic day. I'll talk to you later." And the door slams. And I just pulled away. And I went about 5 foot and I stopped. That knock from the neighborhood's on my head. Throw it at the window. Pull out front, open the door, and launch it at the counter. Go in there, ask for a manager, and complain. I'm turning purple right now. Milton the Monster. Smoke coming out of my ears. I pulled out of the parking lot, made it right. Started heading home. I'm thinking about my day, and I'm thinking about these people that I don't know. I noticed that voice of reason that says, "Tony, you don't know what they're going through. They could have had a bad day." Everybody that you encountered could have had a really bad day today, other than Jim, because we went fishing and it was a great day. I don't know. I don't know, man. You know, like, I can only take so much, and I was furious. And then I'm looking at the news and I'm seeing Putin running over, you know, sending drones, swarms of drones, and killing people in the Ukraine. And I see the Hezbollah, you know, launching missiles over at Israel, and Israel's fighting back and defending itself. And I see these people shooting each other on the streets of Philadelphia and wondering what would possess somebody to try to kill another fellow human being. What kind of love is that? Does that matter? Do they matter to each other? Did they know each other? It's all the time, folks. And I tell you, you can really get down when you allow these things in your head and you think about it and you think about the world that we're in. And suddenly I segue to voices of reason, voices of illogical concepts and thoughts, the political conversations I've had with people, the refusal to see both sides of a story and see only one side. And then I look at myself in the mirror for a second. I glance up, see the eyes look back at me. I've looked at them for the entire life that I've been on this face of this earth, and I'm like, is this all going to affect you, manipulate you to act as if you're a result, you're in this world, or you're of this world? Are you going to act that same way? You're going to be rude back to people? You're going to be ignorant back to people? You're going to be disrespectful back to people? And then I thought about this podcast, and I'm like, you know, well, I haven't done a show in months. Bink and Bobby and I, we haven't done it. Why we haven't done it, we've just been so busy with a lot of different things. I know I have a lot of health issues going on, you know, and life just happens, right? And then what's there to talk about when you're in this kind of mindset? Negative stuff. But what I want to talk about and what the moral of this story is, folks, is to disconnect to connect, is to take those times to yourself, is to limit the amount of exposure that you have to possible negative effects on your mind, what you're seeing, what you're allowing inside your head, what you're allowing people to tell you and convince you. And like that old horrible song that was played over and over and over and over and over and over back in the 60s and the 70s to brainwash you and to go buy it at 45. Don't buy into this crap. Take the time to use your own brain and think for yourselves, and don't let people's hatred, people's negativity, people's venom, don't let that suck you in. Take time for yourself. Don't expose yourself all the time to it. It's there. It's going to be there when you're dead and gone. It was there way before you were ever alive. It's human nature. It's human nature to try to draw in other people, to share the negativity, to look around and say, see, we all feel the same way. We all hate you. We all hate that. It's easy to hate stuff. It's easy for me to want to throw my three Taco Supremes at that dude who was being totally ignorant to me. It was easy for me to just stand there and maybe not move when that lady said, what are you doing here? Didn't you see the gate? Didn't you see the little black movie theater fence thing that we put in your way to prevent you from coming over to the register that's open for you to work for us? Listen, man, we're only here for a little while. I mean, it's a long time, but it's not a long time. It gets scary when you got things going on and you get tests done. And you're like, man, I want to be here next week. I want to be here in a year. I just want to be here and I want to get along with everybody, man. I want to enjoy this wonderful place. So I ask you what this is about. It's about being a voice of reason within yourself. It's about you're going to encounter people with really negative thoughts and outlooks. And they might look at you and see you as a reflection of something that they hate, something they resent. And you can't do anything about that. But you can refuse to get into their vortex of negativity. You can refuse to join those energy vampires in their party of misery. It's a choice. And so I had remained silent for, I don't know, man, 3 months, 4 months. How long has it been since we've done a show? Because I was like, I'm not talking about anything that is on my mind right now. Because I don't have anything good to say. Because I've been surrounded by negativity. I've been surrounded by adversity. I've been surrounded by discourse and things that affect us in life. Adversities, again, the word. And life goes on. And like my brother-in-law said yesterday, just get it done. Live your life. Get it done is a procedure I got coming up. Just get it done. Live your life. And I choose to do that. And I choose to say, you have a nice day. I choose to say, you have a blessed day. Why does that sound weird when I say that? People look at me like, oh, what are you being funny? No, I'm not being funny. I think it's a great thing to say to somebody. Because I truly believe every day to me is a blessed day. Every day I wake up is a blessed day. A couple weeks ago, I was down in South Carolina. Yeah, and that's the other thing, too. I've been on the road a lot, folks. I was down in South Carolina, and out in front of us, this guy comes by with his young kid. And really big, like, I don't know, like 20 feet, 30 feet wide. He writes, Jesus loves you. But he writes it like Jesus hearts, a heart, you know, and then you. And he turns around and walks away, and he's got a Jesus loves you shirt on. Jesus heart you. I'm like, yeah, okay. That's a hard thing to think of when you let the world get inside your mind. And right now, I want to ask you to ask yourself, have you let the world inside your mind right now? Because you probably be feeling like I'm feeling right now. You know what I'm talking about? Have you let the world inside your mind? I have. Pause 1 second. I gotta do something. Hold on. I'll still talk to you from across the room, but... Hello? Some people are going to be coming home in a couple minutes, and I just want to make sure everything's... They see that I'm recording, the door's shut. So, what do you think? It is so easy, especially nowadays, to see the hatred in people, see the violence in people, and you start hating them back. What's wrong with these people? Why do they think the way they do? I'm hearing it all. Why would you vote for someone who already had 4 years and the world is still, our country is still crap? You're going to fix this. You're going to fix that. What did you do the last 4 years? Other people. Why'd you let that criminal go? He's a criminal. He belongs in jail. We are so divided. And that is so sad. And trust me, folks, that's a strategy. Divide and conquer. Hate each other. Hate so much that'll give you venom to go vote against that. All that you detest. There's another side of it. Like me. Does a person really think that way? How can they possibly think that way? Let's have a little dialogue and talk about it. How about we talk about it? How about we try to understand just a little bit? And you are going to encounter people that will not see your way no matter what. But you know what? It makes you a better person and a bigger person. Just try to understand where they're coming from. That doesn't mean you're going to accept it. That doesn't mean you got to like it. That doesn't mean they're going to like it. But maybe you're just going to get it a little bit more. And what I'm encountering, what I'm seeing out there is a whole lot of ignorance. People just choosing to believe what they wish to believe so it conforms to the way of life that they want to live and so they feel better about it. And that's how I guess we get through life, right? Everything that we deal with, every single problem, we think about it a certain way and then we kind of, here we go, compartmentalize it. My friends love that word because I do that often. We compartmentalize different things and put them in an area where we can organize it all, our thoughts even. And we make sense of it that way. Not everybody does that. Only geniuses. I heard that. Oh, right. Here we go. That's what they said. A couple buddies of mine. But this is what we're dealing with. So with that, listen, maybe there's some, you know, surmise everything I spoke about today is you're going to be seeing a whole lot of negativity out there lately. You're going to see it in all the commercials. Maybe shut the TV off. Here's a thought for you. To take a piece of paper. Yeah, here he goes. Tony has a piece of paper. Exactly. I'm telling you. On the left, what's important to you? Maybe in regards to things, policies, what you would like to vote for. On the left, write down your pros. On the right, write down your cons. And then see if your candidate is blowing smoke up your butt and telling you they're going to take care of that. Right? There's a whole lot of talk goes on. Just look at people in a lot of urban cities. They're the people I feel sorry for. We'll talk about promises made and promises not given. How much suffering has to continue in urban environments for these people, hardworking people that just want what you and I want and everybody else wants, a safe living environment, education for their children and their family, job opportunities, healthcare. How hard is that for both sides of the aisle to get together and figure that out? How hard is it for both sides of the party to get down to the border to look at the actual problems, all the little angles that people have that they come here? You know how many times we send jets to go get people in other countries and bring them here? There's things that you have no idea about what's happening, but people know how to work it. So can't both sides of the aisle try to figure out some form of legitimate variations for this immigration policy to work properly? How long have we been complaining about this? I am all about immigration, folks. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm second generation immigrant. My mother and father first. My grandparents, immigrants. Didn't speak English. No speaker. No speaky. On my mother and grandmother and grandfather on my father's side, no speaky. They spoke Italian, pizza, lasagna. The Irish side. Isn't that how Irish people speak? I kind of sound Swedish a little bit there. I don't know Gaelic. I don't know how to speak it, but you know what? I mean, we're different. We've all come from somewhere, folks. But we got to make it easier because I'll tell you right now, our country would not operate, function, if it weren't for those folks out in Bakersfield working on the farms in the heat, doing jobs that us gringos would never do. So immigration is extremely important. We got to work it out. We got to fix it. There's a whole lot of things we got to fix, but empty promises, you know, sorry, don't know what the answers are. I'm just telling you today, think for yourself, will you? Think for yourself, get out there, and just do not forget that we are all fellow Americans, and I don't think we should hate each other because our enemies are loving this. But maybe be there for each other. You know what? In times of how many people, oh, jeez, what happened here? Oh, here we go. How many people can do that? Lost the whole screen. How many people can do that? How many people have the maturity to be able to do something like that? To be sure enough in themselves to say, you know what? There's got to be two sides of the story here, even three. Again, go back to the restaurant analogy. If someone's dropping a ball, someone's not doing what they say they're going to do as a boss, do you keep them or do you fire them? Anybody out there who knows anything about business, let's just say you have somebody working underneath you. If somebody's working for you and they didn't do half the things that they promised to do, are you keeping them or are you firing them? And what do they stand for? I'm not telling you who to vote for either way. I'm just telling you to think about things. Go vote. Make sure you vote. The worst thing you can do is not vote. You know, because that's so many people have died for your freedom to go vote and to live your life and to do whatever you wish to do and worship however you wish to worship. Yeah, it's funny. I see these young people, you know, marching through the streets of cities and neighborhoods with these different flags, and they want this and they want that. They don't have a flying ass clue what it's like to live in some of these third world countries. They have no clue. They have everything they wanted in this country. They've grew up with opportunities. They have no idea what it's like. Just talk to somebody from whatever country it is that you worship so much, and you'll hear the truth. We got a great thing going here, folks. We have freedoms that you would not believe, but you give them away. You wish them away, and you got another thing coming. So, proud to be an American. That's why I'm not a singer. Whatever party you're for, God bless you. I love you. Family, friends, have you on both sides of the aisle. And I love you all, and I respect you all. The only thing I would ever ask is open your mind a little bit and let's talk to each other instead of, well, this is how I say it. And he's an idiot. And that guy's an idiot. And that guy's a moron. Fine. That's great. Let's talk about it sometimes if you want to. For whatever this podcast is called anymore, I'm Tony. Got any podcast ideas for names? I mean, it's probably going to go up under Finding Subjects today, but I really don't care anymore. It doesn't have to be that. It could be whatever. It could be 45 minutes of bullcrap, whatever you want to call it. I don't care. Send me some ideas. Waste of time, whatever. Think for yourself. I like that song by the Beatles, Think for Yourself. I like that. This is America. Live from planet Earth. Honestly, that's what I'm leaning towards. Live from planet Earth. Maybe we'll call it that. Live from planet Earth. Maybe I'll change the name. If you don't like that, let me know. But I hear now Deem as emperor of Finding Subjects to call this podcast Live from Planet Earth. We are live from planet Earth, wherever you are in this universe, if you hear this. Get in touch with us. I got some great real estate to sell you. Oceanfront, up and down the East Coast of the United States. Yeah, just ask me. I mean, if you're from another universe, yeah, you're going to need a representation, a representative here. So I can be that guy for you, a mediator, if you will. As long as you put me last on your food list, on your menu, you know, and you don't want any barbecue Tony right off the bat. So if for any reason that you might be coming here to invade us, I'm your guy. I'll point you to the right areas. And I hear my buddy over there is holding up a sign, blue states. And there's another clown over there, red states. So that's how even we are here, folks. So who knows where I'm going to direct the aliens towards? You never know. Could you imagine that? Yeah, I'm the only communication between Earth and all other life forms out there in the universe and beyond. This is the only podcast that's getting through for some reason, live from planet Earth. So hook me up. I'll hook you up, and I'll set you up with, you know, prime real estate in L.A. or Washington State or Florida, wherever you want, Jersey Shore. I'll introduce you to some Jersey tomatoes. You'll go back bringing the stuff back to your planet. You'll be a star. All right. We can start an interplanetary vacation resort here. Maybe you're already watching us, right? Maybe that's what you do. Maybe that's what you do. Can you imagine that? What are you doing this weekend? Let's go to Earth. Just hang out. Like, it's incredible there. We're like, maybe we're like a B-rated movie. We're so like, let's go watch the war. Let's go watch them kill each other. Or where do you want to go today? I don't know. Let's go to the Ukraine and just watch that for a little while. The Russians fighting Russians. This guy says he's going to take over, you know, Ukraine because it's part of Russia. He's going to just kill all the Russians. Let's go watch that for a while. Like, what other civilizations, if they were out there, what they must think of us? The savagery. You know, but maybe other universes and other life beings are all about that. Yeah. And maybe they're warring entities, right? That's all they do. Yeah. All right. Who knows? But what if we're just a... What if we're just... Here we go. Let's get really deep. I was in a band with this guy, and he would think about this stuff when everybody was like, you know, had a few drinks or those guys were high. I didn't get high. What if everything we know about our universe, everything, it all exists on the tip of a pin? What if we're everything we know? We're so small that everything exists on the tip of a pin. Oh my God.
There's people to think that.
There's people to think that we are the end all be all. But what if we're not, man? What if there's other people out there watching us? I'm trying to just keep your mind open here for other things, man, and humor you a little bit. Anyway, I'm glad to be back. Let's see if we can get this thing rolling again. Just felt inspired to talk to you. I've been so negative in the past 3-4 months. I just couldn't take it anymore. And I figured, you know, let's talk about it. That's what we kind of do here. Here we go. It's kind of what we do here on Live from Planet Earth.
That sounds weird to say.
Live from Planet Earth. I think it's time to write a song. An intro. Ready? Live from Planet Earth. All right. You stay tuned. You come back. You follow. Tell me what you want me to talk about. And we'll do more. All right. This is Tony. Thanks for listening. And you take care of yourself. And just be cool out there, man. Just be that person. Be that better person. All right. Be that better person. Turn off the news. Don't listen to them people. I feel so peaceful already. I think I'm going to go fishing. See you. Bye.
Peace. Live from Planet Earth.